I'm gonna go to Sasserville. Prepare yourself, you know it's a must. You gotta have a friend in Jesus. Cause you know that when you die, he's gonna recommend you to the spirit in the sky. He's gonna recommend you to the spirit in the sky. It's where you're gonna go when you die. When you die and they lay you to rest, you're gonna go to the place that's so best. That's where I'm gonna go when I die. When I die and they lay me to rest, I'm gonna go to the place that's a bell. Where I'm gonna go when I die. When I die and they lay me to rest, I'm gonna go to the place that's a bell.
Good morning, Renew. How are we today? Let's stand on up and get ready for this worship. God, we thank you so much that today we learn how to grow deep and wide roots into who you are. God, we thank you that today we get to praise your name, for you are holy and you are wonderful. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, see, nothing can tear us from the grip of his mighty love. We've only glimpsed his vast affections, heard whispers of his sword and passion, his glory. Oh, it's of his deep, it's of his wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, his love is strong, it's joyous. His love is sweet, his love is wild, his waking hearts to life. Our Father loves and sends his Son. Our Son lays down his life for all. Such love upon us, and he calls us now, and his sons and daughters, he's reaching on. His love is deep, his love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, his love is strong, he's furious. His love is sweet, his love is wild, it's waking hearts to life. Oh, let's sing of his love. His love is deep, his love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, his love is strong, it's joyous. His love is sweet, his love is wild, it's waking hearts to life. God, you're waking hearts to life. Oh, you're waking hearts to life. With your love. Your love. Your love. Your love. love is wide and it covers us. Your love is fierce, your love is strong, it's furious. Your love is sweet, your love is wild, it's waking hearts to life. Oh, yeah. Oh, some is deep, some is wide and it covers us. Love is fierce, love is strong, it's glorious. Love is sweet, your love is wild, it's waking hearts to life.
we thank you for all that you've done for us. You are a faithful and a good Father. God, this morning, would you just begin to awaken hearts, God, the people who have come here broken. God, they need you. They need your love. God, would you just begin to breathe your breath of life into those people? God, would you begin to breathe your breath of life into this city? God, and BB and Valonia and Bryant, God, would you begin rising up, Father, the army that's going to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name.
This morning, as we continue with our worship, as we have a chance to partake of communion and get our minds focused in and think about how the past week has gone, as we continue to look at possibly resolutions or decisions that we've made, there's one thing that is kind of important in all this, and what we try to do and what we try to get done and what we try to change is we've got to do more than just show up. And whether your resolution has to do with physical change, mental change, spiritual change, again, God's thankful. We're thankful. He's excited that you're here. But we've got to do more. We've got to show up. He calls us to do more than just to be a body and just to take up space. And this morning, as you partake of communion, as you hear God's word being preached, that you look at and hear and open your hearts and open your minds to the word and to put yourself in a position to know that God calls you to do more. He wants you to do more. And we can't grow closer to Him. We can't grow closer to the Father without doing more than just showing up. And so as we take this time, really meditate and think about where you can do better, where we can do better as a church, where we can do better together to move forward, as Jordan prayed about, just not here in Cabot, but other communities surrounding us as well. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your support. This morning, as we get ready to partake of communion and get to be involved in something that is that you've done from the beginning, we pray that we can open our hearts and our minds to your message, to prepare ourselves to step up, to do more, no matter where we are in our walk right now, no matter where we are mentally, right at this moment, that you call us to be more, to do more, and we pray that you can allow us to let go of things on the outside, things that may be a distraction for us, and allow us to grow closer to you. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. Again, there are stations in the front and the back. I encourage you to either together, family, friends, by yourself.
calmed and broken for my recovery. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well. And wind.
Father, here we are. Help each one of us to say that and mean it. For those that come here with celebration on their lips, to those that are broken and scared and afraid, for those that are lost, and those that know you well, for those of you that need healing, to experience your loving touch, help each one of us to be able to declare that it is well because of who you are and all that you are and all that you've done and all that you're doing. Lord, help us to know that you've got us, those that know Jesus and have accepted his gift of grace, who are called sons and daughters. Help us to know that you, our Father, loves us and cares for us. And so, Father, just because our music is done for now, let not our hearts stop worshiping. But instead, as we open pages of Scripture to see what it is that Paul had to say so long ago, that we will take this as our message from you, that we will be moved by you, and that we will be changed, transformed from the inside out. And then when we leave here today, we're different because we have been in your presence. So, Father, help us to declare that it is good because you are good. We praise you for what you've done. We celebrate you for all that you are. Thank you for giving us this moment in time. It is in the name of our Lord Jesus that we pray. You can have a seat.
There are hundreds of ways to connect in this world. You can call someone or share a photo. You can travel to exotic locations and stay connected on your wall. You can even squeeze your connections into 144 characters. But what's the best way to connect? Connections happen best when we're in community. When we're in church, engaged in people's lives. Connections happen in small groups. When we invite people into our homes or have a cup of coffee together. Connections happen with a smile or a handshake. Or even a simple good morning. Connections happen when we take the time to let others know they matter. Look, it all comes down to relationships. You and someone else, face to face. Take the time. Make the time. Get connected.
Connections are absolutely vital. If you cut a fuel line, the engine obviously will not run. If you unplug an appliance, it will have no power. If you take a coach out of the scene, the team will often flounder. And if you stop watering a freshly cut Christmas tree, it will become a dramatic fire hazard. In fact, we just got back from Kansas City, spent a little time with our family after Christmas. And when we walked in the door at my wife's parents' home, the first thing I'm pretty sure they told us was, no matter what you do, don't light a fire in the fireplace, because the tree stopped taking up water 2 weeks ago. And in other words, you're sleeping in a matchbox and there are 100 toddlers running around with lighters. That's really what that meant. At least that's what I heard. So, you know, that's a problem. But if you stop watering and giving nutrients to a fruit tree, it will not bear fruit. In fact, it will just wither away and die. If we were to stop communicating with people that we love, a spouse, friends, coworkers, or whatever it is, if we stop the lines of communication, then the relationships fade away. And if we stop gathering together as the body of Christ, if we stop gathering together, spending time alone with God on a consistent basis, the power that we need to live is interrupted. The strength that we need to function and to move in a crazy, messed up world goes away. And it's like removing our own life support. and we fade away. Connections are vital, and whether it's leadership, relationship, or workmanship, we need those kinds of connections. They're absolutely necessary in our lives, and I will tell you that the book of Colossians is a book of connections. Now, all of the Bible is about connections. It's about connecting with God and connecting with one another, connecting with the lost, connecting in with all that's going on. Of course, the whole Bible tells that story, but the book of Colossians in particular is about this connection with Christ through faith, through a faith in him which leads to eternal life, and it's about our connection in the middle of that as the body of Christ gathered and scattered as we come to this moment. And so let me ask you, how are your connections? How are your connections going? How's your connection with the Lord? How's your connection with the body of Christ, that is the church? Are they strong or weak? Are they temporary or secure? Are you barely connected or deeply rooted, deeply connected with all that God is and all that he calls us to? We ask the question because it matters. And this year, here at Renew, we want to build those connections. We want to help us grow in those connections and strengthen those connections. But anytime you begin talking about strengthening connections with the Lord or connecting with the body, the church, the devil will oppose it. The devil will come after it and try and break that connection, to try and unplug things, to snip things along the way. The devil will absolutely come after it, but we can't allow him to win. We have to grow in these connections, and we can grow in the connection with the Lord and with the church, that is the body. The church has nothing to do with this building or infrastructure. It is us, his people, gathered together in his name. We can build those connections in such a way that the people that know you, or the people that see, or the guests that have come, or the people that we serve in this community will see the connection here and here and want it for themselves. That the fruit that is born out of our connection with one another, and what happens when we are fully devoted to the Lord, what comes out of us as an act of overflow is contagious. And people take that and want it for themselves. And the end result of that is salvation of thousands and thousands of people who will one day be in heaven because of the connections made right now, right here, connections for eternity. That, my friends, is the gospel truth. Maybe you've heard that phrase before, the gospel truth. It's usually something someone says when they're trying to make a point that this is the absolute truth, although in our culture we might use it in a flippant way. But the gospel truth is what the gospel says, and the Bible describes the gospel in lots of different places and ways, like in Acts 20 and 24. It says the gospel of the grace of God. In Romans 1:9, the gospel of Christ. Romans 15:16, the gospel of the glory of Christ. Ephesians 6:15, the gospel of peace. Or Revelation 14:6, the eternal gospel. The gospel is, as Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, verse 5, that it is the true message that has come to you, church in Colossae, and as I say to you now, it is the true message that has come to you today, church in Renew. That this is the message that Paul had in mind for the Colossian church, that they would see this true message, that it has come to us for a purpose in order to bear fruit. But this gospel message is literally our good news. Now, this Greek word, if we were to do a little study here, the good news, the gospel, the original word that Paul would have used as he was writing this, and the word that he did use, is this word, euangelion, or euangelion. Go backwards, keep on that slide for a minute. And so this word that he would have used is broken down into two parts. The EU means good. And then the angelon, which is where we would get the word angel, is a messenger. An angel's a messenger. Angelon is a message. This is the good message. This is what Paul is talking about and what he's using. And we use this word as a root for our word evangelize. As we are to tell the world about the good news of Jesus, we are evangelizing. Euangelion is what Paul would use there. Now, if we were to go back into secular Greek literature, we see this word being used from time to time. It wasn't a super common word, by the way. And in fact, what we would see is that when Jesus used it, they would have heard it a certain way. The way they would have heard the word when Jesus and the disciples said euangelion is they would have heard it as a victory in battle, that the good news was about a great victory over sin. person that they're battling. This is how they would have seen the word, the original hearers. And one of the most famous examples of it is, which is called the Prine Inscription, which would have been written back in 9 BC. It was part of a letter from the proconsul Paulus Fabius Maximus. I was thinking, Jennifer, we could have another kid and name him this. Is that okay? I think that would be cool. We could call him PFM just for short, because no one else would be able to pronounce it. Paulus Fabius Maximus in 9 BC engraved this prine stone, this inscription on there, many, many years ago in the city of modern Turkey, which is particularly significant because this is where the church in Colossae was, which is where we get the letter Colossians from. And so here's what it said, and we will see this idea of good news used in secular literature. It seemed good to the Greeks of Asia, in the opinion of the high priest Apollonius of Menophilus, Azanitus. If any of you want to have a kid and name him that, you're welcome to. Since Providence, which has ordered all things and is deeply interested in our life, has set in most perfect order by giving us Augustus, whom she filled with virtue, that he might benefit humankind, sending him as a savior. Augustus was sent as savior, both for us and for our descendants, that he might end war and arrange all things. And since he, Caesar, by his appearance, surpassing all previous benefactors and not even leaving to posterity any hope of surpassing what he has done, and since the birthday of the god Augustus was the beginning of the euangelion, the good news, the victory over life and all things, the world that would come by reason of him. This inscription, this prime inscription, is so famous because of all the things that it says in there. It calls Augustus God, and it calls him Savior, and that through him, victory is found. But of course, we know that it was not Augustus. We know, in fact, from the book of Luke, and Luke, and when he tells the Christmas story that we just finished a couple of weeks ago, Luke is really the only author of the Gospels that sets the story of Jesus on the world stage, and we find this story even of Augustus right here. In Luke chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "In those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered." You know that story. We've talked about it recently. And in verse 11, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." It was not Augustus who brought salvation. It was not Augustus who was God, but in fact, Jesus. In fact, when they would have heard this story originally, they would have said, "Wait a minute, we've always been told it was Augustus, but in fact, it is Jesus the Lord who fulfills this role." This is important for us to understand. And of course, when we begin to look at the euangelion, the good news, we find good news for ourselves as well. That the good news isn't just a victory over some secular battle. It's not some victory in war. The good news in Jesus, from a biblical perspective, is about a great victory, but it's victory over death. It's victory over sin. It's victory over Satan. And that's what our good news is all about. We see things like that in 1 Corinthians, for instance. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We see a summary of the good news, the euangelion, the great victory in 1 Corinthians 15. Let me just read the first four verses. "Now I would remind you, brothers," now this is Paul that's writing, "I want to remind you of the gospel I've preached to you." This is not a new thing. They've heard this before. Paul is reminding them, and sometimes we have to be reminded. Is there anyone in the room that has to hear a message more than once? Anyone? Four of you need to hear it more than once. Let me ask again. Is there anyone in the room that needs to hear a message more than once? All right, so Paul thinks so too. So do I. Here it is. "I'm going to remind you which you received and which you stand and by which you are being saved." Salvation comes through this message. We need to not miss it. Sometimes we need to hear it over and over again. And if you are thick-headed like me, when I was still a heathen in my early 20s, I needed to hear this message multiple times before I went, "Ah, I don't know about you," but sometimes we need to be reminded. "I hear this," Paul says this, "which the gospel which you've been saved, you hold fast to the word I preached to you." That means hold on tight, unless you believed in vain. "For I delivered to you as a matter of first importance." Here's the thing. He's going to talk about the resurrection. Without the resurrection of Jesus, there is no Christianity. And so this is a matter of first importance. "What I also received," in other words, this is not Paul's ideas. This is inspired from God himself to Paul, to us, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with Scripture. And we've talked about it before. We could spend weeks talking about the prophecies that Jesus fulfills over and over again, hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus, that say that he's coming to do the things that he said. This is why Paul is so emphatic about us hearing it, that Christ died for our sins according with Scripture, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to Scriptures. That this is not a surprise. We've heard the message before, but this story of Christ crucified, buried, and risen again is our victory song. It is our good news. It is our euangelion in this. And this is why Paul writes the story to the Colossians. This is why he begins the way that he does when we go to the book of Colossians, and he begins to give thanks for the church in Colossae. And so I want to take you there for a couple of minutes to the book of Colossians. Now, if you're not familiar with how this works, Paul, many of the books in the New Testament are actually letters that are being written to churches. This is part of what Paul is doing. So he's writing a letter to the Colossians, which is a church in Colossae, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And so he's writing a letter to the church. It would be as if I were writing a letter to the church in Cabot or to the church of Renew. And so they're receiving a letter. So Paul is writing this out. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus. Now we'll stop there for just a minute to make sure we have our foundation set and we understand what's going on here. Now, here's the thing. In ancient times, the author of a book or the author of a letter, they would put their name up front. As opposed to us, we generally put our name at the end of something. Now, it is true that you can type more of a letter than 160 characters. We all know that, right? Although most of our letters are done like this, maybe on a good day, you type a letter like this, and it is a little longer than one text message worth. Back in the old days, we actually used paper and pens to write letters. Whoa. I know, it's totally weird, huh? And on that, then, you would say such and such, sincerely, Spencer Dunlap, or whatever. We would end our message with who we are. In ancient times, because it was so important about who had credibility and who had authority to say something, they would put their name at the front. And this would, of course, give you an indication that says, when I open this letter or the scroll, I get to decide whether or not I want to read the rest, based on who wrote the letter. And so Paul starts it out that way. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. By the way, apostle means a chosen one, a sent one. It is an ambassador, if you will. And Christ has called Paul to be an ambassador, a missionary. And now the truth is, we are all. Every one of us, in a generic sense, are called to be ambassadors of Jesus to the world. This is at least an overarching theme for everything we do here. Part of the reason you're here is to be equipped as an ambassador, that when you leave this place, you represent heaven. You represent the King of Kings. Here together, we're being equipped to go out. It's not just about a holy huddle. This is grand. I love it. But it's not just this. The work begins here. It does not end here. And we go out as ambassadors of heaven into the world. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God. In other words, God has willed it that Paul communicate this message. Now, we see Paul's story in Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 9, that says that he was called into this work, and I'm not going to take the time to read the story to you right now, but it's an amazing story of Paul's conversion experience, and I want you to hear it, at least a little bit of it, because it's important for somebody in this room right now, that Paul once was called Saul, and he was breathing threats against Christians. He hated Christians. He wanted them to die, to go to jail in chains, and he is on his way to go get permission to tie up more Christians and throw them in prison and have them murdered. Saul is on his way. As he's on the road to Damascus, he has a literal come to Jesus moment. Jesus appears to him and says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he's blinded by this vision. The people around him that were there, they heard it, but they didn't see it. They take him into the town. He goes into a house. He doesn't eat or drink for 3 days. Finally, they come and pray over him. The scales that had formed on his eyes fall off, and he can see. And the very first thing he does is he's baptized before he even eats or drinks. I love that, by the way. The priority of the gospel is, I want to surrender my life to Christ, and then I'll worry about my physical body. He's baptized, then he takes food and drink, and he goes out to proclaim boldly the message of Jesus. He has a complete change, not just inside out, but from Saul to Paul. God gives him a new name, a new start, a new beginning. So for some of you in the room, some of you watching online, all over the world right now, here's the truth, and you need to hear it, that if you have been lied to and you've believed the lie that you're too bad and too far gone from Christ to be saved, quit listening to that voice. It is the voice of the liar. You have not gone too far. If you can be Saul and have a come to Jesus moment and have a turnaround and God use you to do the most amazing of things, if it can happen for that guy, it can happen for you. And so by the will of God, Paul brings this message, and he brings Timothy into it. And Timothy, our brother, I love it that Paul brings Timothy into it at least six different times. He talks about Timothy, and what this really does is Paul is demonstrating for us a team ministry approach. There's no question that Paul is sort of the leader, the primary leader in all of that, but he drew strength from his companions, from his fellow workers in the harvest, that Paul brought others in to assist in the work that needed to be done. This is the sign of a healthy church. This is the sign of healthy leadership. It's what we do right here at Renew. Some may think, well, Spencer gets up and he orchestrates this and that and whatever. You know what? The truth is, on a Sunday morning, here's pretty much what I do. I hug you, I shake hands, I preach. I really don't do a whole lot more than that. Everything else is going on behind the scenes by staff, by volunteers, by people who have skills, bulletins. Every little piece, everything's taken care of is by an entire team of people that love Jesus and love you. And this is important. In fact, I don't even know the password to the internet here. I don't. I tried to today. I had to go and figure it out because I couldn't even print something. I don't even know those things. Why? It's because we have a team of people that know and to do those kinds of things. Part of by Paul saying, Timothy, our brother, is we have a team approach. This isn't just about Paul. This is about what God is doing in his people. And by the way, in a team ministry approach, it has practical benefits as well because it's part of the connection. The connection that we have to hold each other accountable, to grow with one another, to love one another, to support one another, because it's possible to have a bad day in ministry. I don't know if that surprises you or not. It's possible to have a bad day where you just want to go and hide in a corner and suck your thumb. That happens sometimes. And you need someone else to come alongside and go, it's okay, I love you. Let me pray for you and let me get you a cup of coffee. That happens a lot. And that's okay. We need each other, and we need this all together. And so Paul says, with Timothy, to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Now, a lot of theologians will say this is two different people, the saints and the faithful brothers. I don't buy it. I think this is the same group. I think it's very easily the same group, not two separate ones. When Paul talks about the saints, he means those who are separated to God from the world. In other words, we're called to be in the world, but not of the world. We live here. I've had so many people say, look, I just can't wait to die and go to heaven. And that's great. I'm with you. That will be a wonderful time to go to heaven and experience all that God has in mind. But while I am here, I have work to do. And I will work until I am dead. That's how it goes. Spencer Dunlap does not have a retirement plan. My retirement plan ends hanging out with Paul. That's my retirement plan. Okay? That doesn't mean I got to burn out for Jesus. I've heard all those things. No, it's not that. When you're doing what God calls you to, this is good and it's joyful. But while we are here, there is work to do. And the answer is, I am in the world, but I don't want to be of the world. I want to be separated to God here. That is what a saint is. That means that we live a holy life because of our connection with God the Father through Jesus the Son, with the Holy Spirit in us welling up and leading us and guiding us in everything. This is what Paul's talking about to the people who are the saints and the faithful brothers, which is not just a masculine thing. The faithful brothers is about those who believe in Jesus, who are called his sons and his daughters. And we are brothers and sisters because we have a common Father. This is who Paul is writing to, and he's writing to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Now, Colossae, again, was a part of what we would now know as Turkey, the country of Turkey. And in Paul's day, although it had been a big deal city at one time, by this point in time, while he's writing, it's a small city overshadowed by more prosperous neighbors. And the church in Colossae, to whom Paul is writing, was planted by a man. It's a church plant. Planted by a man by the name of Epaphras. And Epaphras was doing a good job. He had taught the gospel well. It was a good church, but the church was in danger. And Paul was called in to help with this. Here's what was going on. As you read through the book of Colossians, you'll find that there is heresy that is trying to creep in. The church there was composed of some pagans, some Greeks, and it was composed of a bunch of Jews. And so you had the creep in of paganism and the creep in of ceremonialism, which are the Jews that are saying, no, salvation comes from doing these right things. It has nothing to do with your heart. And Paul is coming in to deal with that stuff. And then there was one last heresy that was trying to creep into the church in Colossae, and that was this idea that Jesus was not sufficient by himself for salvation. That you needed Jesus and knowledge, a special kind of knowledge. And they were teaching that Jesus was not sufficient in and of itself. You had to know some more things. This is what the root of what we would call Gnosticism in the later in times and even in these days, where they would say you need Jesus and, but let me tell you, there is no Jesus and. Jesus is sufficient. Jesus is where salvation comes from. But Paul needed to come in and deal with these things. And so he begins then with grace and peace to you in Colossae. This is important. Grace and peace to you from God our Father. Now, grace, I love the idea of grace. I love the picture of grace. I love the image of grace in my head. Now, grace is simply defined as a gift that you do not deserve. But when I think of grace, when I close my eyes, maybe you can do this and you can see it. Grace, for me, pictures God stooping down to sinful, lost humanity in love and tender compassion, and pulling us out of the mire and the muck of the world. That in our everyday lives, we start to drown in the mire and the muck and the filth of this world, and God, our loving Father, reaches down to his sons and daughters and grabs us by the arm and pulls us up out of love and compassion. That's what grace is. It is a picture of Jesus catching Peter as he gets out of the boat. But he takes his eyes off of Jesus and focuses on the storm. Oh, there's a sermon there for a bunch of us. And as he takes his eyes off Jesus, he begins to sink, and Jesus grabs him and pulls him back up. That's a picture of grace. A gift of life when we really deserve death, but it's God reaching down and pulling us out of the mire and the muck. And peace, which would have been a common Jewish greeting in those days, peace comes out of that. That once we begin to experience the grace of God in Christ Jesus, it gives us peace. Peace is the result when we know that we have a Father in heaven who is our rescuer, who has rescued us and will rescue us. It gives us a sense of peace. At least it should be. Hopefully it is for you. And also, this order is important. Never do you see Paul write this, peace and grace to you, because there is no such thing as peace without grace. It always is in this order. Grace must come first. Then peace. It always is this way for Paul, because if God had not acted out of love and mercy, we would still be lost in our sins. And there's no peace in that. But when we begin to realize the gospel, the good news, the euangelion, the victory over sin and death, it allows us to have peace with God. It allows us to have peace with one another. It wants us to have peace right here. I think the right here is sorely missing in our world. I don't meet a whole lot of people out in society in general that just have peace. It's just not there. You know why? Because it is impossible to have peace without grace. And the only source of grace is Jesus Christ. That's it. Let me just ask you in general. How many of you want peace in your life? How many of you do? Anybody? Well, this isn't hard then. Peace comes from the grace of God stooping down into humanity and pulling us in the mire and the muck out of his love and compassion for you and me. That's where peace comes from. And so at this point then, Paul prays for the Colossian church. Now, we're not going to have time to do the entire prayer. I love it that Paul documents for us the prayer. We've prayed it here together before, and we will pray it many times. But Paul writes out what he's been praying for the church, much like I might send somebody a text message prayer that says, here's what I'm praying for you today. It's what Paul gives us. He tells us what he's praying, and he begins with praise, which is a good reminder for us that when we begin to pray, a great way to start is with praise. as opposed to, okay, God, here I am. Here's my wish list for the day. I look at that as sort of magic genie Jesus. Like, okay, God, I've got my three wishes. Here are my top three things. If you could just give me, you know, these, that's not the kind of relationship God is interested in. God wants to hear from us. God wants to hear from you. And a great place to start with the one who can speak light into existence from nothingness is to praise him. To praise him for what he's already done. Getting up this morning was a beautiful thing. Now, you may have had trial and craziness of trying to get your children dressed and out the door and all those things. You may have experienced all kinds of stuff, but the fact that you opened your eyes is something you could praise the Lord for today. The fact that you drove here or had a ride here, something to praise the Lord for today. There are a million things that we miss. And I'm not legalistic about it and saying, I don't want to, you know, do the Jesus juke thing. What if you only got what you praised God for yesterday? You know, that I don't want to juke you on that. But the truth is, oh, we have blessings upon blessings that sometimes we just don't think about. And I want you to understand that even with Paul, he praises the Lord for all kinds of things. There's all sorts of things that he wants to praise him for. And then Paul goes on to pray about some very specific things. Paul prays about their faith and their hope and their love. Now, this is important for us. Faith in Christ Jesus, by the way, this is where everything begins. If we miss this, we miss it all. But he talks about their faith as a church. And the faith, by the way, is not just intellectual. I think so many times people think, well, faith is just, I know it's true. I believe it's true. And I think that's part of it, but that's not all that faith is about. When you look back at the original language, when Paul wrote that word faith down, it is the word pistis in Greek, P-I-S-T-I-S. And what that word really means is to be persuaded that something is true, that you believe that it's true, and then you act in obedience because of it. That's actually faith, that I have been persuaded that this is right. I am going to believe that it is true, and now I'm going to act accordingly. That's faith. That's actually what faith means. It's not just, yep, I get it. Faith is actionable. It is obedience. And by the way, our faith is not blind. Our faith is not stepping off and leaping into the dark. Our faith is based on fact and grounded in evidence. And we will continue to proclaim that for a long time here. And your love, Paul goes on to talk about, your love for all the saints, they didn't just love a couple people. They loved each other and they loved beyond. This is something as we begin the journey of planting other churches, that we're called to love them as well. And other Bible-believing churches that may not carry the same name, that we love the saints. We love those who are following the Lord. This is what Paul is calling them and telling them that they're doing a good job. And by the way, then he goes on to pray about their hope. Faith, love, and hope. Our hope is imperishable. Our hope is undefiled. Our hope will never fade away. This is what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Our hope is an anchor that is connected to God's throne. That's what hope is. It's an anchor that is connected to God's throne that we get to hold on to. That's hope that says there is a coming a time when there will be no more pain and sorrow, and I can live this life with that kind of hope. Hope is an anchor, and we have hope because of Jesus. And because we have Jesus, we're sons and daughters of the King. Faith, hope, and love. This is so important, we don't want to miss it. Faith, hope, and love, which is what Paul is addressing right in the beginning of the Colossian letter, it needs to be our measuring stick. The measuring stick of a healthy church is about faith, hope, and love. This is a primary goal. This is why Paul addresses it over and over and over in his letters. When he addresses the Corinthians, he doesn't talk about faith, hope, and love. Why? They didn't have it. In fact, Paul said that church was so worldly, he couldn't tell them apart from the world. They didn't have faith, hope, and love. But you get over to the Thessalonian letter, they had all three, faith, hope, and love. Or you get to Ephesians, they had faith and love, but no hope. And Paul needed to help them work on their hope. And the Colossians, they're doing a good job. Their belief is grounded in biblical truth. They're exhibiting all three things. Epaphras has done a good job of planting the church. But faith, hope, and love is the indicator of health. You know, around here, we stopped counting attendance months and months ago. it's an easy place to get caught up in. And you think, well, we did a great job because we had lots of people today, or it wasn't a great day because very few people showed up or whatever, and it's easy to get sidetracked. Now, of course, we want quantitative growth. You want to have people come. It is an indicator of health, but it's certainly not the only one. And in fact, what's so interesting, you never find a place in the New Testament where the people there are praying prayers of thanksgiving for bringing lots of people. You just don't see it. You don't see Paul going, God, thank you for having 872 people show up today. That was fantastic. It was a great day. You just don't see that in there. In fact, what you see is, yes, it's important to have numerical growth, but qualitative growth is really what we're going for, which means that when you come, you're growing and you're changing and becoming more and more like Jesus. Faith, hope, and love. And then Paul goes on in verses 5 and 6 to help us understand that where that comes from. It's the word of truth, the gospel, the good news, the euangelion, the victory is where faith, hope, and love come out of. They've received this. They understand this. They're walking in this. And they need to hold to that truth and not get persuaded by the false teaching that was around. And just like in the day of Colossae, we are surrounded by false teaching all over the world right now. Would you agree? But to hold to the truth of what the gospel really is so important. And when we do, wherever the gospel has gone, fruit is born. Wherever the gospel had gone, it's bearing fruit and growing and increasing. That's what it says in verse 6. You know, oftentimes fruit trees will not both bear fruit and increase at the same time. They often will not bear a lot of fruit and grow bigger and bigger and bigger well. And so what happens many times is you have to prune the tree. You have to prune the fruit tree. That way, the energy of the tree is not going to produce more leaves and branches. It's going to produce good fruit. And if the tree is enormous, what happens? A lot of the fruit grows up inside the canopy of the tree, and it's sick because it can't ever get to the sunlight. And so you prune the tree so that the fruit gets all the energy and the fruit is beautiful and good and healthy. But the gospel can do both. The gospel can bear fruit and increase. Growth occurs. Fruit is born. And the saints are being built up and growing, and it bears fruit for the salvation of souls. And it spreads from city to city, nation to nation, then and now. This is what Paul's talking about. And it was always and has always and will always be God's plan that the good news, the victory, will spread everywhere. And so why is this so important? Well, you know, as Paul is encouraging the church in Colossae to be careful, to not hear false teaching, to not allow false things to creep in, but to focus on faith, hope, and love, the grace and peace. As Paul is telling them about bearing fruit, so I am telling you today that it was not just a call for the church in Colossae, but it is a church for Renew. To make sure we hear the truth, to operate out of that grace and peace, to be healthy in our faith, hope, and love, the true measure of a healthy church. How's our faith? How's our hope? How's our love? And out of these things, bear fruit. Pass it on everywhere we go. This is what's happening here. This is what's happening right now in this city, in this church, and hopefully this is what's happening in you individually. Bearing fruit, that's what it's called, what we're called to, that we have growth that is increased, that it's occurring. And yes, we've been growing numerically. There are new faces all the time. And hopefully we're growing spiritually, and I know it's true. Hopefully you are as well. And the result is bearing fruit. And that fruit will be planted in cities around us, starting in Bryant and all over Arkansas and beyond. Salvation hangs in the balance, not just for Cabot, not just for Bryant or Beebe or Valonia or North Little Rock or Conway, or wherever, the truth is the message of the gospel was designed to spread. The message of the good news, the victory over Satan, sin, and death through faith, hope, and love, empowered by God's grace and the peace that he gives us, empowers us to go and bear fruit. You know, fruit like an apple tree is pretty interesting. The fruit protects the seed. The seed is actually the really important part there. The fruit protects it, it nourishes it, and the fruit is pretty enticing. If animals see a nice, plump, red, juicy thing there on the ground, they are usually inclined to do what? To grab it and take it somewhere and eat it. And what happens? Well, the seeds then fall to the ground and they begin the process all over again. This fruit is carried off by animals. It's part of the way that God designed the system. In order to bear more fruit, one tree produces hundreds or thousands of apples or whatever the fruit is. And as those hit the ground and roll, as animals eat them and take them elsewhere, those seeds hit good soil, hopefully, that the seeds fall into good soil. And it germinates because of the right moisture, the right nutrients, and it all starts over again. They carry the DNA of the tree to other areas, and it takes root and eventually bears much fruit. And then that tree does the same. And then the next tree does the same. And the next tree does the same, repeated hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. And by the way, none of that hurts the original tree. It's not a division, it's a multiplication. The tree that bears the fruit only bears the fruit because it's firmly rooted and connected. But it's not division that allows the fruit to continue and to expand. It's expansion and multiplication. This is and will be our story as God has laid it out for his gospel to bear fruit everywhere, whatever he calls us to. And so where do we go from here? What do we do with this? Well, our theme for 2017 here at Renew is to bear fruit. We're going to spend a lot of time on this in the book of Colossians and in other places, but we've been talking about multiplication really since our five-year anniversary. We announced it for the first time. We did that great outdoor service, and we talked about God multiplying us. And although bearing fruit is what God has called us to corporately, that means as a church, again, he calls us to it too, individually. To bear fruit in our lives, it's not just something I can do. It's not just something our staff team can do. It's something that we must do together. Must. It's not one of those, well, we'll just have the staff at Renew do all that stuff. I'll tell you, we have one of the smallest staffs I've ever seen in a church this size. They all laughed just now. So what's necessary? It's a call to the body of Christ. And I don't accept the 80-20 rule here. That 20% of the church does 80% of the work. It needs to be the opposite. That the church is gathered and scattered and called to action. And it is a call for every one of us. Everyone has a part to play. We need workers in the harvest. We pray for it all the time. Luke 10:2. For God to bring workers in the harvest. Whether you know it or not, you're an answer to that prayer. If you choose. We pray for workers in the harvest. By the way, next week we have a volunteer luncheon about this time after church next week. We did this 3 months ago. We had about 80 people show up, and we celebrated those who are volunteering now and those that need to volunteer or want to find a way to connect. It's time to do it. That's next week. You need to be here for that. This is a part of the call for us to be workers in the harvest. Financial provision. We're going to have an offering here in a few minutes. It needs to grow and to not get handcuffed by money, because the truth is God has called us to all sorts of things and he will provide, but he calls his church to go into action. We need prayer support for people to pray consistently for the work that God has in mind. One of the things I do and many of you do is in our phone calendar, we set 9:11 a.m. and 9:11 p.m. And it reminds us to pray for the work that God wants to do in this city and in this church. why 9/11, if you're new to Renew, it's because we launched September of 2011. And when that 9/11 alarm goes off, whether it's at home or with one of you, we stop and we pray for God to be glorified and to do his work and for nothing to be a barrier that stands in the way. Wouldn't it be amazing if everyone that called Renew home prayed at 9/11 once or twice a day? Oh. We need you to be an encourager. Spread the word. Spread the word of what God's doing here more so than you spread the word about my tattoo. That word of the picture of that tattoo, man, it went everywhere. What if we spread the good news of Jesus better than that? What if we told the message about what God's doing in this place and a story about bearing fruit and multiplication better than that? It needs to happen. It needs to. Let's have faithful attendance this year. It's a great day. Room is full, both services. Don't let it be because it was a New Year's resolution that fails next week. But have faithful attendance and participation, not just to show up, but to be a part of what God's doing, build relationships, get connected. We need our church family to dig deep. Yes, to be a mile wide, but a mile deep. To dig deep in the Lord every day. 40 minutes with me is not enough for you to grow deep this year. 40 minutes once a week is not enough. But to take time tomorrow to go and see what God has to say, this is how beautiful fruit is grown in your life. Don't skip this part, but let this part motivate you as you are sent out from this place. Get connected. Today at 12:30, 12:40, we'll have a connections class. We'll feed you lunch, have kid care. We want you to come back and see what it means to get connected here at Renew. And along the way, don't forget, the devil will oppose it. But don't backbite, don't slander, don't gossip. The devil loves division, and he will try and jack it up every chance he gets. Don't let him. Resist it and fight it. And let's do what God has called us to do, to take ground for the kingdom of God. And for you personally, bear fruit. Bear fruit of the gospel in your own life this year. And so let's get connected like never before. Connected to him and connected to one another. Let this be a major focus. These things will help us take root and bear fruit. And so here's the invitation. As Jordan plays, ask him to help you get connected with him and others. Ask him to help you. Just read through it and let it be your prayer to make that commitment to him and his church. Ask the Lord for faith, hope, and love in your own life and in us as a church. Ask him where to use your time, talents, and treasures to serve the Lord and his church. Ask him to be Lord in your life for the first time or again. It's time for some of you to get off the fence. Ask him to bear fruit in Cabot, in Bryant, in Beebe, in Valonia, wherever you live, in all of Arkansas and to the ends of the earth. This is the story of the gospel. You will receive power to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You, Renew, will receive power to be witnesses in Cabot, in Bryant, in Beebe, in Valonia, to Arkansas, to the Midwest, to the United States, and to the rest of the earth. Because we have victory, euangelion, the good news of Jesus. Would you take a couple of moments as we pause and reflect to pray and then to worship? And then we'll come back together in a few minutes.
Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here, I find my without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Just stand and worship with me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. One way you are, Lord, I am free. And holiness, it's Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll follow you. Oh, Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
You guys can have a seat. So we have a couple of baptisms to celebrate today. And so this is Don and Kayla, and we want to baptize them in the Lord. This is a beautiful story. We had time to talk this week. And for both of them, it was a time to die with Christ and to begin brand new, to be washed clean. What a great story. And so, Don, based on your confession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. That's good. And Kayla, based on your confession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. All right. God, thank you for giving us this moment that we can celebrate this way. I pray that you will give them the strength and the courage to follow you all the days of their life. We praise you for this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Okay.
Let's respond with some more worship this morning. The sin runs deep, your grace is more, where grace is found. Where you are, where you are, Lord, I am free. It's only this Christ in me. Oh, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. You're my my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Oh Lord, you're my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need.
All right, I think we have a This Is Why I Give video now.
And you guys can take a seat. Thank you.
My name is Ryan Caldwell, and this is my wife, Sharla. And we are going to tell you why we give.
You know, we haven't always given well. We haven't always given obediently. For a long time, we really didn't give much at all.
We gave more, oh, here comes the plate. What's in my pocket? Or what's in my purse?
Yeah.
And it was not anywhere close to a tithe.
And it certainly wasn't sacrificial. You know, really what happened to us is that we reached a point where, for whatever, you know, for financial reasons, we had an injury and a layoff, and we got to a point where we literally had nothing. And we were forced at that time to depend on God. And He came through in such an amazing way. It's not really even describable in words, but that was the people that helped us through that time really talked a lot about the obedience of giving and how we were supposed to be giving back according to what God has commanded us to do. A couple years ago, we took the Financial Peace University course here at Renew, and that opened our eyes a lot. And that class taught us to trust God with our money. We already trusted Him with everything else in our lives, our kids, our home, our livelihood, but we weren't trusting Him with our money. It doesn't even make any sense. So we made a conscious change, and we began to tithe on everything that came in, regardless of whether we could afford it that week or not. And the most amazing thing happened, we didn't go in the negative. God sometimes shows you things in really strong ways, and He has showed us that trusting Him with our money is a big deal. It is about Him being Lord. It is about
us obeying.
I got one shoe on. I'll work on the rest. It's holy ground. My feet are naked. Sorry. So let's pray. God, thank You for a testimony like this, and I pray that we will grow in it, and we will learn to trust You as Lord and Savior. Even in this, which is sometimes one of the scariest things to give up, is control of our finances, but I pray that You will motivate us as we desire to follow Your lead, and that You will give us the ability to give You our time, talents, and treasures, that we surrender all in all for You as You lead us. It is in the name of our Lord Jesus that we pray. Amen. Well, as they come through, thanks for that. Good job. We have a few things that we want to share with you. So first of all, let me just say, I'm so thankful to be back. I'm glad we had a little family time in Kansas City, but this is home. And I was so glad to get back here. So really happy about that. Hey, just a couple of quick things to celebrate for you, and then we have a few announcements for you. One is, near the end of the year, I put a note out there that said, hey, we would love to raise about $7,000 or so to be able to purchase some things for ministry tools that we don't normally use money for, because the truth is, we're pretty cheap. We can pinch a penny.
We don't spend a lot of money here.
Yeah, we don't spend a lot of money. In fact, most of the nice things we have, someone gave to us. In fact, like the big nice TV out there in the lobby, that happened because a friend of mine came one day, and he goes, what do you need? I said, a big TV in the lobby, and he mailed us a TV.
So if you're watching.
Yeah, Jordan, we need you to come visit again. And so, anyway, but we put a note out. We'd love, you know, about $7,000 to do some of the things that we really needed to do in some of our ministries, like buy some curriculum for the kids, to be able to get some freezers and coolers built over here that we need for our food pantry, because we feed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. Well, we had $5,000 come in, which was really close to that seven, and that's a huge celebration. Yeah. And then we got another check in for $7,000. And so that God has done above and beyond what we asked for, and that will be a great tool for us to be able to do some things in ministry that we'd not normally do. And so very thankful for that, and we just want to praise God for that, and I would ask as you remember those things to praise Him for it. So we have a couple of announcements. This is Dixie.
Hi, my name is Dixie, and I'm on staff here at Renew. If you're a guest, I'm so glad that you are here. We have been praying that you would be here. Just a couple of things today. I think Spencer mentioned it earlier today at 12:30, so like in 6 minutes.
Yeah. 12:40. How about, we'll say 12:40.
12:40. We we've got, if you are ready to call Renew your home, we have got a connection class at 12:40 where we'll feed you lunch, we'll feed your kids lunch. You can sit in here and you can just learn about Renew, and you can learn about why we do what we do and our mission here. Also, next week, the 15th, if you're a volunteer, which a lot of faces I see, I know you guys already volunteer either at the community center or right here, we'd like to celebrate that. So we'll have a volunteer luncheon. Again, there'll be kid care. There's always food. I think just about everything we do has food in it. So we'll feed you lunch. And then also, if you're interested in volunteering, that's a really great time for you to come, because what we're doing is vision casting what's coming up over the next quarter so that you are completely aware of what's going on in your church home. And, oh, and Big Serve. Big Serve is on the 29th. I just really want to cheer because I feel like we haven't done Big Serve in a long time. So, yeah. Yay, Big Serve!
Big Serve.
Okay. We'll have sign-up sheets next week. But a couple of things we're going to do. We'll have some work over at the community center building those walk-in coolers. So if you have a specialty in, like, working with fridges? With
commercial refrigeration.
If you like to build stuff, come next door for Big Serve, and we've got stuff for you to build, and we'll have other things, and they may even go into the new cities that Renew is starting to go into. So we may have some stuff in Bologna and BB to do our Big Serve on. So that's on the 29th. Put it on your calendar. And just one more thing is renewcabot.org. I'd love if you guys made renewcabot.org like a bookmark on your tabs in your phone or however you connect, because there's a calendar there that's up to date. You will never not know what's going on if you go to renewcabot.org. You can also give online and do all kinds of stuff there, but I really want to promote that this year. It's a great way to answer a ton of your questions. So
it's great.
Oh, and yeah. You say.
Okay, so a couple real quick things. If you have a teenager or you know a teenager or you used to be a teenager, grab one of these things. There's some out on the front, but it's a winter retreat that's coming up. We want your kiddos to come out to that. And so if you need more information, it's right here, January 20th, 22nd, $60 for the kids. Don't ever let money hold you back. If you need some help, we can just talk through that with you. But we want your kiddos there. And then men's and women's studies start again tomorrow night. So ladies, 7 o'clock. Woo-hoo! Guys, 7:30. And we're doing some vision casting for the year. Planning for the year, what do we want to do, what are some of the ground we want to take for the kingdom and all that good stuff, and studying together. And so if you haven't been or it's been a while, ladies, 7 o'clock, guys, 7:30, we have kid care, and we really want you back. The last thing I want to say is, hey, that was the first time we did a baptism with our drum set thing. It worked. Although
I told you we could still do baptism.
I went to flip the switch and it was stuck, and I went, oh God, no. And it opened. Yes, thank you. So it was good. Hey, I love you. I'm thankful for you. Let me pray you out. God, thank you for giving us this time to be here in this place. We praise you for all that you are, all that you've done. We praise you for all that you will do. We know thousands will come to faith in you because of the work you're doing right now in this place. And I thank you for those that we will meet in heaven one day because of what you're doing in and through us, but not by our power, but by your own. And so we celebrate you for all of it. In the name of our Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we'll see you back here in about 15 minutes for Connections class.
Lonesome but always searching, homesick but nobody's heading home soon. Keep on keeping on keeping on. Long days too.